Aaron Rodgers is coming to Chicago. The Green Bay Packers are coming with him. The game is for first place at Soldier Field on Sunday afternoon, the 4-1 Packers against the 3-2 Bears. We've got a mid-October showdown. Feels good that it's got some big game feel to it. I'm Dan Wiederer. That's Dionne Miller. You feeling the energy building up towards Sunday?
I am. I mean, just that sentence you just said, that Sunday is with that lead in the division technically on the line, right? Like the Bears can have a share of first place after week six. Like that is not a conversation I thought we would be having, especially after the first 2 weeks of the season and the crazy we've heard around where they are right now. You're feeling it. I mean, like I joked yesterday in my story that the Bears had this like Vegas swagger to them. And I think they do. They have a little more confidence. That naturally lifted everybody up. That was not beating the Detroit Lions. That was beating a team now we see that was in shambles behind the scenes, but we didn't know that. And the Raiders are good. They have a good pass rush. They were 3-0. They had a lot going for them. This is a team that we watched the Bears go on the road and take care of. And yeah, I think there's reason to be excited about that.
I was asked if I was surprised that this game was for what it's for at this point. And I said, surprise is not the right word because it's still early in the season. If the Bears and Packers are still playing for something when they meet at Lambeau Field in week 14, December, then I'll be surprised. And then the Bears season will have taken a turn that we didn't expect it to turn. I will say this, that coming out of the Cleveland loss, the path that the Bears have taken to get to 3-2, yes, they beat the Lions, yes, they beat the Raiders, has required a level of resilience. It's required a level of fortitude. Yeah. And it's required a level of just kind of on-the-fly reinvention that they have succeeded with. And it's been impressive to see the mental toughness of this group that only goes so far, as we've talked about 1,000 times, but you can only handle what's in front of you. And for them to be able to handle the cleanup of the Cleveland disaster in the way they have the last 2 weeks is impressive. Now, Dionne, my worry is how much have the last 2 weeks taken out of them from an emotional and an energy standpoint? Wednesday, when we were up at Hallis Hall, it felt like Justin Fields was a little low energy. It felt like Matt Nagy was a little low energy. And I joked with my colleague, Colleen Kane from the Tribune. I said, if I had to make my prediction based on Wednesday morning body language, I'm taking the Packers by double digits. We'll see if the Bears can get themselves back up. But that is something to keep an eye on, just how much energy has been spent the last 2 weeks getting themselves to the starting line of this game.
I would argue that the fact that Green Bay has won 17 of the last 20 meetings is the reason to say Green Bay by double digits. But yeah. I agree with you. I do agree with you that the energy was low in around those guys yesterday and when they were talking.
And who knows why, right? Sometimes it's just an hour blip on the radar.
Correct. Like there, who knows why? And there's only so much you can read into that. But what I did hear is that resiliency from Justin Fields and his answer that jumped out at me was about your question about his aggressiveness, right? Like, are you going to continue to be aggressive? Because there were moments on Sunday where I think Bears fans were like, oh my gosh, like he looked like he was being bent in like a pretzel. And he kept getting up and he kept getting up and he hyperextended his knee, which was also cringeworthy. Oh, and it was like, what is he going to be able to handle this? And his answer was, because it's not about me, it's about the team. And I'm out here of course I'm going to continue to be aggressive because that's what my team needs me to do. And I'm going to do what they want to make sure we get this done. And that just really like caught me that I'm like, this is a kid who sounds like a veteran, right? Like he's just rolling with it. And even not fazed by this whole, you know, doesn't it juice you up to go against Aaron Rodgers? He's like, that's not the matchup, you guys. Like that's okay, great. And his stat line might be better than mine, but if we win, that's all that matters.
So let's dive down a little bit on Fields for a minute, because I think it's important to kind of highlight some of the things that he's shown here in just 3 short starts as a starter. Going back to the topic of the aggressiveness, you look at, obviously, the hyperextension of the knee is on a play where he's trying to get outside the pocket and make a play. Second series of the game, he gets out on a scramble and tries to do that spin move that he's promised us 100 times that he's not going to do anymore and takes a shot, right? And has to go to the bench and it clearly has lost his wind. And it's like, oh, man, how many times is he going to subject himself to one of those hits? Well, Matt Nagy and Justin Fields have both said, both after the game Sunday and since, that some of this is situational. Right. If that's second down and 6, Justin Fields is sliding or finding the nearest way to protect himself. But it's 3rd and 4 and he's trying to keep a drive alive. And so it's that situational awareness of this calls for me to be aggressive. This requires me to try to give life and limb to get this first down. And if I take a hit, then that's just what comes with being the quarterback trying to make a play to put together a game changing moment. you hope that awareness stays there, Dionne, because I think we saw in Mitch Trubisky's time as a Bear that he gets hurt late in the 2018 season when he's running and Harrison Smith puts the late hit on him. He gets hurt the next year in week four when he's outside the pocket trying to make a play and gets pulled down by Danielle Hunter. And it seemed to me that that took away some of Mitch's instincts and aggressiveness to run when it was available to him, right? I looked at the stats. He had 8 games of more than 40 rushing yards before the first time he got injured in that Vikings game in 2018. Only 2 times after that did he rush for at least 40 yards in a game. And so you say, okay, how much of that was sort of subconsciously like, I don't want to subject myself to one of these hits that's going to knock me out for a few starts. Something to keep an eye on with Justin. I think what you're hearing from Justin and the coaching staff is there is a level of situational awareness to when to be aggressive and when not to. But obviously, the more hits you take, the more hesitant you may be to take another one of those hits.
Oh, 1,000%. But what you just described is the difference between Mitch Trubisky and not having that experience, not having that mental toughness that Justin Fields had, because he had those experiences in college and he had more of those reps on bigger stages, and he just comes with a different kind of mental toughness. I think we hear it in his speech. That's, you hear it in all of that. He has arrived here prepared for this and feeling like he's ready for this, and taking those hits. It is also cringeworthy to watch him turn. Like every time he does it, I'm like, oh my gosh,
you're like, oh God.
Stop, you know, like, and but it was, he, we're watching him learn on the fly. This, he was not supposed to be learning right now as he's going, and he is, and his ability to tell us to recognize that in himself, I think, is what's going to push him past this and to continue to have that awareness and to continue to be aggressive. When he says it, I think he's honest about it.
To me, the toughness is so notable because obviously week 3 to week 4, you come out of Cleveland and you got to put yourself back together mentally after such a disastrous loss against the Browns to get ready to play winning football against the Lions. And obviously Fields showed a level of mental toughness in that week to be able to pick up the pieces and put his offense and his team in position to win a game. Obviously in Las Vegas, he showed his physical toughness, right? It's 2 injuries, right? It's a shot that knocks the wind out of him. It's a knee hyperextension that could have taken him out for a long time. And he shows that he's not going to stay out of the game. These are things that earn you clout. And trust from your coaches and teammates as a leader, as a guy that is going to do everything you can to help your team win. Those are important strides. I think Justin, obviously, you would agree, is going to need to make strides with the passing game. 3.5 games three and a half games plus since Andy Dalton got hurt. 35 completions, 448 yards. You know, that's a good afternoon for Patrick Mahomes or Aaron Rodgers or Tom Brady. Like, the Bears passing attack is going to have to produce more than that. And so, eventually, Justin's going to have to be more statistically productive, but certainly you see some of these moments, particularly with the toughness, that are impressive.
Yeah, and I think that's why we go back to a matchup this week that it does still feel lopsided and does still feel like the Packers are going to go to Soldier Field and do what they have done for years, right? And totally dominate this rivalry. And Justin talking about, he knows rivalries, obviously, Ohio State and Michigan, but what does he remember most about those? Beating Michigan. Well, right. Welcome to the other end of the stick, dude. Like, this is not, the Bears are the Wolverines of this rivalry. Like, they have not been able to stay competitive, not to mention, like, the Packers aren't threatened by them. Like, not at all. So how is this still an intense rivalry? I was rubbed totally the wrong way when Aaron Rodgers was asked if he could remember all the different Bears starting quarterbacks that he has faced. And he casually, like, spouted off 3 or 4 and said that that's all he could remember. Now, I wanted to go back and see how many exactly were there, because the list is incredibly long of starting quarterbacks, not just against Green Bay, but just how many different starting quarterbacks the Bears have had since he took over, since he arrived in Green Bay. Yes, but since he took over.
Like, he arrived in 05, took over in 08. So are you going to give us the full list? I know that I know I've seen quite a few start in this rivalry, and this is year 9 for me.
So when he arrived in 2005, Rex Grossman, and then he watched, you know, Rex Grossman, Kyle Orton, Brian Greasy, then Jay Cutler. Okay. So it was Jay Cutler. Well, Kyle Orton was in 08. So I'm thinking he might have faced Kyle Orton, right?
Yeah.
Kyle Orton, Jay Cutler.
Kyle Orton for sure.
Todd Collins was in there somewhere, but I don't think he faced the Packers. Caleb Haney, Josh McCown. Jason Campbell was also starting quarterback for a hot minute. Jimmy Clausen. These are just, I don't know if they all face Green Bay, but these are just the ones that have gone through that time.
Guys who have started, right, since Aaron.
Guys who have started in that time frame. Okay, so obviously Jay was the most. Brian Hoyer, Matt Barkley, Mike Glennon, Mitch Trubisky, Chase Daniel, Nick Foles, and now Justin Fields. Justin Fields is the 17th different quarterback the Bears have started during the time that Aaron Rodgers has been with Green Bay. That is startling.
Did you mention Andy Dalton? Andy Dalton probably would make it 18, right? Because he didn't obviously start against the Packers, but a lot of those guys didn't. It's crazy how much the door has revolved at that position. I remember a game where Brian Hoyer got hurt at Lambeau Field, and all of a sudden you're like, wait a second, we're now watching Aaron Rodgers against Matt Barkley. I remember watching Mike Glennon. The last game that Mike Glennon played for the Bears, taking shotgun snaps off his shin and it flying around. We obviously know, Trubisky and his history against the Packers, and it wasn't great. And man, it's a long list, and it's hard to believe that the Packers have had that luxury. Couple quick things just on the Bears offense. Obviously, I think that they have found a way to establish an identity. Can we say that? We've been searching for the identity for years. They're devoting themselves to running the ball. So far this season, they have 634 rushing yards, 566 net passing yards. In the NFL in 2021, for a team to be at mid-October and week six with more rushing yards than passing yards is absolutely unfathomable. But what it tells you about this team is they have at least recognized strengths and limitations and have turned loose an offensive line that has played physically, that has played with assertiveness, that has understood what is being asked of them the last 2 weeks. And they've run the ball 75 plus times. I think it's 76 the last two games. And so you say, okay, if that's a way to complement what is already a really strong defense on the other side of the ball, then so be it. Have at it. Go ahead with that formula and that strategy and see where it takes you. Got to give them credit for finding this. Now it's about kind of evolving and hoping that offensive identity is fluid a little bit in the next 10 or 12 weeks.
I looked up several times last Sunday watching Khalil Herbert, and I was like, oh my gosh, he looks like David Montgomery. And I was really impressed with the way that he attacked it, the way he worked, and what his teammates have said about him and how dedicated he is and how he's in the building and he's putting in the work. And I think we saw that right away, which makes you feel a little bit better about losing David Montgomery. But you spout off all those stats about the Bears offense. Still last, right, Dan? I mean, like, still
32nd in the league by a long shot.
And that's why
it's important to contextualize all this stuff, because look, the next 2 weeks you're going up against Aaron Rodgers and Tom Brady. You're probably going to have to play a game of keep up at some point, and so that's not going to get it done.
No, it is not. The next 2 weeks are going to be very interesting to see. I think I don't want to call it like some sort of measuring stick because Justin is so new to this, but it is going to be interesting to see how the offense can evolve and grow against really good teams and watching an offense like where they want to get to, right? They'd love to be an offense that looks the way that Aaron Rodgers makes the Packers look. They'd love to be an offense the way Tom Brady makes the Bucks look. So that's the goal, I think. And like to be on the field against them is going to be interesting to see. I don't want to say measuring stick. I think it's too soon for that, but I'm interested to see, especially too, how Justin handles all of this. You know, he is competitive. Yeah. He's incredibly competitive. He knows it's not against him and another quarterback, but he wants to win. He wants to win. And he's going to, I think he's going to hear that Aaron Rodgers soundbite. I think they're going to play that stuff at House Hall and hear the media giggling in the background and not want to be the laughingstock in this rivalry.
And say, let me be the starting quarterback for 8 or 9 years, right? And then there'll be no more additions to that list for the duration. Two more things on Fields before we turn our attention to the defense. I think two things that I find notable at this point. Number one, he hasn't been putting the ball in harm's way. I think he only has one turnover this season, and it's on an interception that was on a ball deflected at the line of scrimmage. Not much you can do about that. So impressive for a rookie quarterback to make sure that he's not making those game-losing mistakes that a lot of rookie quarterbacks make. Taking care of the ball, protecting the football. I also want to point out his touchdown pass to Jesper Horsted on Sunday. It's his one and only touchdown pass so far. Again, you're going to need to have more than one touchdown pass to qualify as having arrived. But that's a play that Justin's making on play action on a rollout to the right. And he's got to make a split second decision with a linebacker barreling in on him and hitting him as he releases the ball on whether to put that ball in the seventh row of the stands at Allegiant Stadium or take a shot with it. In his head, he looks and he sees the Raiders cornerback with his back turned. Split second risk reward calculation says, I can throw this to Jesper. At the very least, it's incomplete. Otherwise, it's a touchdown. And so that aggressive mentality, that's not just aggressively reckless, it's aggressive and calculated, saying this is a play that we're either going to make or we're going to get a new down. And he throws it in there. Horsted makes the great catch. And all of a sudden, you've got a touchdown on the board. Those are things that are absolutely huge moments in a growth process of a young quarterback. And again, it's a split second risk reward calculation that then tells your coaching staff that this is not going to be a dangerous situation as often as they might fear it will be.
You know what the narrative that surrounded him the first couple of weeks was, he's got to learn the difference between college open and NFL
right.
open, right? And I think we saw against the Raiders, he was making passes and completing them to guys who were NFL open, right? Where the defense was right there and he was finding ways to get them the ball and had the confidence to do it. And I think that's where we're seeing that growth right away.
No question about it. And so now we have to ask, can he beat Aaron Rodgers? Can he beat the Green Bay Packers? Can the Bears pull off this upset as a team? I go into this week, Dionne, a lot more, I guess, optimistic is probably the right word, that they can hang around in this game longer than I would have thought a few weeks ago. And it's a lot based on the way this defense is playing right now. Matt Nagy challenged this group after the Rams lost to be a swarming group, to be consistently around the ball and flying around with purpose. They have done that the last 4 weeks. They did it in Las Vegas. They had a road stadium filled with, as we talked about last week, about 40 to 50% Bears fans electrified, right? It was really cool for the Raiders to be facing third down in their home stadium and have to deal with crowd noise, right?
Awesome.
Because Bears fans were so crazy. And some of that's attributable to the way the defense was playing, putting themselves in situations where the crowd was revved up. This defense has been revved up for 4 weeks. I think it's a credit to their pass rush up front. I think it's a credit to what Sean Desai is doing every single week in playing that chess game. And that was what I talked about coming into the season, is Sean has this elite intelligence about him, a Fangio-like ability to dissect an opponent, match up their strengths and weaknesses against his defense's strengths and weaknesses, and position guys for success. It's been impressive to watch.
Lead the league in sacks. They are getting pressure, that is for sure. I am interested to watch how they try to disguise what they're doing, because they all praised Aaron Rodgers for his ability to walk up to the line of scrimmage and change what he's doing to pick apart your defense, right? Like, he is so good at that. And I want to see if the Bears can keep this up. And what is interesting to me is what they were able to do on Sunday without Akeem Hicks, which we've talked about how much he can be that heartbeat in the front of the defense and that defensive front that's like putting that pressure on, and for him not to be there and they still had that success, I think that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, they're able to scheme up some rushes that are a Khalil Mack sack. He comes in basically running a game, and he runs into another offensive lineman that says, oh yeah, by the way, I'm going to go this way and I'm going to smother my old good friend Derek Carr and let him know that I'm still here. It's impressive the way they're getting home. And then you mentioned Aaron Rodgers, right? And the way he takes things apart. It was very interesting to hear Jalen Johnson, now just in his second year in the NFL and only had one game last year against Aaron Rodgers at Lambeau Field, say, man, sometimes you get up to, you know, the play's about to start and Aaron gets up to the line of scrimmage and he's pointing out and saying things that give the obvious indication that he knows exactly what coverage you're in. And you can't change your coverage at that point. There's only, you know, 6 seconds left on the play clock. You know that he knows what you're in. You know he's got something up his sleeve to beat it. And now you've just got to try to figure out how to minimize his ability to beat everything you do. I know we talked last year coming out of that game at Lambeau Field when Rodgers gave that like minute and 45 second answer on the touchdown pass he threw to Davante Adams about how impressive it is for him to be so surgical about every single thing he sees pre-snap and post-snap. And so Jalen Johnson goes into this game Sunday, Dionne, having to defend Davante Adams. So let me give you some numbers on Davante Adams. I know you like the numbers.
I do like numbers, but this is going to be tough to counter. All right, go ahead.
Coming off a career game against Cincinnati where he had 206 yards on 11 catches. He now leads the NFL. He has 42 catches, 579 yards, 2 touchdowns. The Bears' entire receiving core, every single guy that is in Mike Furry's position room, 46 catches, 524 yards, 1 touchdown this season. So Jalen Johnson, I think, is an ascending player. You hear the praise from him from Tayshaun Gibson. You want to catch the attention of the entire league? Well, you've got 2 straight weeks against Hall of Fame quarterbacks. This week starting with absolutely elite wide receiver who you said the week of the draft in 2020 that you wanted to face as a measuring stick. Here you go. Have at it.
I mean, you're right. This is a huge opportunity for him. And I think he appreciates that. He's so thoughtful, right? Jalen is so thoughtful. And you ask a question and he will answer it. He will pause and answer it. And I think he's that's how he approaches all of this, is he's fiercely competitive as well. And he knows that this is an opportunity to shine against a Hall of Fame caliber quarterback and a guy and a receiver that he is on a sixth sense with, right? Like, they know what each other is thinking. They can finish each other's sentences.
Yeah.
They're that close, that kind of tandem. This is big for Jalen. This is big for the defense to show that, again, that the progress that they've made isn't a fluke.
I said to someone yesterday that I could sit for 6 hours and just watch Davante Adams run routes and then watch Aaron Rodgers put the ball exactly where it needs to be in certain places. It is so pretty as a fan of football to see that type of synergy between a quarterback and a receiver. One last thing on the defense. I think, look, you see DeAndre Houston Carson make an interception Sunday. You see the way Jalen Johnson has played. You see the way that Alec Ogletree has come in off the streets in August, right, to become a contributor to this defense. You see the way that Mack and Quinn are rushing the passer. You see the depth and the quality depth of the contributions, Bilal Nichols, you know, guys that are playing at an elevated level. Yeah. And then that elevated level just creates what you said, that Vegas swagger to play at an even higher level. And all of a sudden, it feels like that momentum is rolling. That's what gives me reason to believe that they can stick in this game. I'm not going to pick them to win because I've seen this movie too many times.
Same.
But I think the Bears can hang around in the fourth quarter, and we're going to be sitting in that Soldier Field press box saying, man, this is an entertaining football game.
I believe that as well. I think that you're right. I actually kind of hope it all comes down to a field goal kick, because clearly advantage Bears when it comes to that, because just get Mason Crosby out there, get in his head, he'll miss them all. Cairo Santos wins it. I'm not ready to pick the Bears either. Not yet. I mean, I agree with you. I think they have a shot. I believe they have a better shot coming out of the last 2 weeks in the way that they've played and turned things around since that debacle in Cleveland. Is rock bottom a turning point in a season? I think it can be. I think they can continue to build off of that. And for Justin to take control the way he did out of that, like, it gives me reason for excitement this week. And his calmness, ways, as we talk about all the time, I think that it's going to be interesting to see now that he's getting this first taste of it. And Darnell Mooney said, he's like, I thought I understood. I got a little taste of it last year, but it's different, and it's going to be different for Justin. This matters so much to the franchise, to the fan base. This is the game that matters, and I think he's ready to shine.
By the way, on the topic of kickers, I think I've got to do the exact count, but I think there were either 26 or 27 missed kicks around the NFL in week 5. That's field goals and extra points by everyone in the league. The Packers and Bengals were missing them left and right and keeping that game and turning it into a circus. Meanwhile, Cairo Santos hasn't missed a kick in a year plus, right? And so you send him out there for 46-yard field goals, and you can hear the dinging of the bells with the points going up on the scoreboard, because you're like, Cairo is locked in and loaded. And so let's see what happens Sunday. But, man, it's crazy to see all of this kicker angst everywhere else in the NFL, and for everyone in Chicago be like, yeah, well, what's that all about? We're totally
remember when that was our biggest problem? It's all gone away. Well, now that at least they've solidified that position, and we don't have to have like this Augusta silence at practice and having to kick indoors. Kicking on Wednesday, Cairo was hitting the bullseye on his field. I mean, it's like in the net, he was right dead center. I mean, he is so locked in. It is pretty funny to remember that is all anybody thought we were.
It's not that long ago. It's not that long ago, and now all of a sudden they're completely calm and composed. So it's gonna be fun Sunday. I know. I'm looking forward. I'm sure you are as well.
I cannot wait. This is a matchup that's always a good time. I love the noon kick. I love the energy of it all. Should be really fun. I say the Bears keep in it too. I do. I'm gonna go 24-21 Packers. I'm gonna keep it low.
I'm not ready to give a score yet. But
well, you don't have to. I'm not pressuring you. I'm just saying.
I do. By Friday, I need to have it in print for the Chicago Tribune. So I've got to do some more homework today and figure out where I'm going.
Technically, the week 6 starts tonight. So
you're right.
Maybe you should get it in before that.
I'll try. Sure. I'll see what I can do.
See what you can
do. Always good chatting with you. Remember to subscribe to this channel, like this video, do all the things that help us bring you these things more. That's Dionne Miller. I'm Dan Wiederer. We'll see you.
Bye, guys.